So yesterday we had discussed about right. You coming for talking only? About which scientist? Ebright, yes. And how at a very young age he developed an interest in so many things. And it was also because of the family situation, the family circumstances that was there. So he was an only child and his mother shifted to Reading, Pennsylvania. He didn't have a lot of company over there. And so his mother wanted to keep him busy. During the daytime when he was there, he went to school and she could not arrange or maybe call so many friends over so that they could spend time with him or play with him. So what did she do? She kept him busy. And as a result, he started engaging himself in many activities like collecting things, right? And so he would collect stones and fossils and rocks and coins. And there was a book which he was introduced to, which actually changed his life. Okay. So hope you have been listening to me and hope you've been reading the chapter, The Making of a Scientist. So if you haven't, please read it. At the end of the book here, yes, so we had done this, right? So he collected butterflies and he was, you can say, maybe we, yeah, Monarch X, so The Travels of Monarch X, he was the book that was given to him. And so the various species of butterflies that were there in his neighborhood, he had collected those and he felt a little bored, but then he got this book. And as he read that book, what did he find? Look at your books, please, page 33. At the end of the book, readers were invited to help study butterfly migration. What is migration? To move from one place to another. And yes, generally we see that birds migrate. We have fish also, right? We have butterflies also migrating, right? For whether it is for warmer climatic conditions, right? And yes, so here also, it is maybe for, you can say yes, for the propagation also, right? For growing. So there, the migration, it happens. They were asked to tag butterflies for research by Dr. Frederick. Tag is not what you do in your social media, right? Here, what is this tag? You know, like you're putting a kind of a, you know, a sensor there to find out where that butterfly goes to. Or maybe like you can say with the name and all of the date of that, that this is the time this butterfly went from here. And will it come back again? So the tag would be there. It would be easier to identify. So if you see on, you know, like all these channels there on your National Geographic also, when they study about animals here. So when they want to study about the growth of the animals or the migration, the movement, so they tag a particular animal. So that animal, the track is kept. So to maintain a record of that. So they were asked to tag butterflies for research by Dr. Frederick A. Urquhart of the University of Toronto, Canada. So here at the end of the book, there was this questionnaire and he had asked them like, okay, you have read so much about butterflies. Let's do the next step. What is that? To tag butterflies. Okay, right? Ebright's mother wrote to Dr. Urquhart and soon Ebright was attaching light adhesive tags to the wings of monarchs. Now, monarch is a kind of butterfly, right? And he's going to study a lot about monarch butterfly. And his research is going to be on the basis of that only, right? So the butterfly collecting season around Reading lasts 6 weeks. In late summer. If you're going to chase them one by one, you won't catch very many. So the next step for Ebright was to raise a flock of butterflies. So he was not able to find all these butterflies. He was not able to tag them. Now look at his level of interest. What did he start doing? He started raising a flock of butterflies. We take care of, you know, we've heard about yes, you take care of cattle or birds or poultry. How do you take care of butterflies? So he raised a flock of butterflies, right? So that is what he did. He would catch a female monarch, take her eggs, and raise them in his basement through the life cycle. So how to identify the male monarch butterfly, the female monarch butterfly? So catch that butterfly, and then from the eggs there, as I said, the whole life cycle, from the egg and the pupa, the larva, or the whatever, all the different stages that was there. From egg to caterpillar to pupa to adult butterfly. So you can write this down, you can underline this. I might ask you, what were the different stages in which the butterflies were there in the basement? Right? From which stage? From egg to pupa to caterpillar, whatever stages. So you have to remember this. Then you would tag the butterfly's wings and let them go. Tag them, write that, okay, this date they were sent from here. And to find out whether they would come back or not. Okay? Then he would tag and let them go. For several years, his basement was home to thousands of monarchs in different stages of development. What does this paragraph show you about, you know? Can you just tell me one quality of Ebright, which is here shown in this paragraph? What can we say about his quality as a scientist? Anyone? Yes? He was caring. Animals, butterflies are animals. Who said that? He was fond of butterflies. That is why. No, why only monarchs? So, yes, he was so dedicated. Very good. The correct word. He was very dedicated. And he was there also very, very, you can say, determined that, yes, I want to help. Right? So Dr. Huard had given this questionnaire and he asked this. Now look at this here. Look at this graph over here. Look at the graph. Now, you know, you might get questions like interpretation of some kind of information, right? So you're asking me, how can you get writing skills? This is one way you might get your writing skills. Okay, your data interpretation you have, yes or no? So what is this data about? Somebody tell me. It's about the kinds of butterfly, yes. What were the, you know, like the most number of butterflies collected? Which were the maximum number? Brush-footed. And the least? Snout and monarch. And which butterfly was Ebright raising? Monarch butterfly, right? So when he was not, you know, this is his information, when he was just tagging them, these were the butterflies that he was able to collect. So he wanted to study more and more about them, wanted to see how many came back. What is migration? Movement, right? So he wants to find that, do they come back or not, right? That is why they were tagged, okay, right? So eventually I began to lose interest in tagging butterflies. So he raised thousands of butterflies, but the output was not as much, you can say, effort that he had made. Okay. Eventually, I began to lose interest in tagging butterflies. It's tedious and there is not much feedback. It's quite tiring and you don't get much of a response. Ebright said, in all the time I did it, he laughed, only two butterflies I had tagged were recaptured. And they were not more than 75 miles from where I lived. And you feel like, okay, you know, like, yes, they have traveled very far and wide, but they've not migrated very far. So 75 miles, they've gone from this place. And how many was able to recapture? Two. So it was quite disappointing. He raised thousands. And so the efforts that he put in, the results were not proportionate. Okay? Yes. Now look at this here. Okay, which butterfly did he write a study about? Monarch butterfly. What are the stages in the growth of a butterfly? Yes. Right. Of course, it is written there. One by one, you can tell me and you can find out what is given over there. And why did he give up tagging the monarch butterfly? Yes, because he was unable to capture them or he was unable to find them back, right? So he was disappointed with all the efforts. Okay, so he gave up the tagging of the butterflies, right? So you can find out more about how this tagging is done, how the distance is measured, right? How do we know that how far this butterfly has traveled, okay? So maybe some kind of, you know, like measurement is there, like, yeah, to find out the distance or how far it has gone. Now we're coming to the next part, and what are we going to read about? Yes, that how he learns about it. What is science actually? Do you think this project that he was working on is, can you call this science? Can you call this a very scientific discovery? No. So this was kind of a research work, isn't it, right? You're getting information. You're getting a inference from it. You're trying to draw a conclusion, right? That is research, okay? What do you think is true scientific work? What do you think is very true scientific work? To discover something new, okay? Very nice. Unless and until you don't experiment with all these chemicals, you don't create explosions in the lab, you're not a scientist. Is it? Okay. Yes, to work on different phenomena, try to find out what could be the cause of it, what effect it has. Isn't it right? So that is scientific. Who do you think are the people who have this scientific temperament? To have a scientific temperament, scientific thinking, scientific bend of mind. See, when we were kids, I think, so each one of you was a scientist at that time because the toys you would get, you would immediately try to open them up, see how they worked, and then try to put them together again, which you could not most of the time, right? So scientific is the curiosity to learn, right? So that is there. It could be, yes, regarding your machines here, regarding that. It could be regarding human beings there, right? It could be about regarding other phenomena which is happening around us. So many of us have that scientific curiosity, okay? Now, in the seventh sentence, he got, in the seventh grade, he got a hint of what real science is when he entered a county science fair and lost. Till now, he had been working on monarch butterflies. That was only science he did. Then he participated in a fair, a science fair, but he lost. Did not get a prize. It was really a sad feeling to sit there and not get anything while everybody else had won something. Everybody else was winning a prize. He did not get a prize. But he was not disappointed. Ebright said, his entry was slides of frog tissue, which he showed under a microscope. Can you call that science? Can it be considered as a science project? He's showing something. He's displaying something. See, this is a frog. Or these are the slides of frog tissue. Can you call it science? No. Right? So it was not. He realized the winners had tried to do real experiments. Not simply make a neat display. So, right, the winners, what did they do? They did experiments, actual real life experiments. And they did not display something. So, otherwise, also when we have these science exhibitions and everything, yes, are they straight? Which exhibits attract us more? One that are working? Yes, you find them more attractive. Something, yes, or that movement is there, or as you said, some kind of reaction happening, mixing of chemicals and things like that, right? Some phenomena happening. So those are the kinds here. That was when he realized that what I did is not science. It was simply just giving information. You're sharing a knowledge. It was just a display. Already the competitive spirit that drives Richard E. Bright was appearing. I knew that for the next year's fair, I would have to do a real experiment. So he's already preparing for the next year. He was not disappointed. He lost. He was not disappointed, but he was even more determined for the next year's exhibition. He said the subject I knew most about was the insect work I'd been doing in the past several years. So instead of going into something new, he said, let me focus on the monarch butterfly and let me find out something more about it, right? So he wrote to Dr. Urquhart for ideas, and back came a stack of suggestions for experiments. So he asked his mentor, that was Dr. Urquhart, for suggestions, and he gave him a long list of experiments. Those kept E. Bright busy all through high school and led to prize projects in country and international science fairs. So those projects there, once he did not get a prize, but then he started working on so many projects that he won prizes in county, the local level, and even international level. For his eighth grade project, E. Bright tried to find the cause of a viral disease that kills nearly all monarch caterpillars every few years. E. Bright thought the disease might be carried by a beetle. He tried raising caterpillars in the presence of beetles. I didn't get any results, he said, but I went and showed that I had tried the experiment. This time I won. So what was the work that he did? That maybe, you know, like monarch butterflies are dying because of this disease. Who's spreading this disease? It could be an insect, another insect. But he could not find any proof that they are spreading that disease. But it was an experiment. It was science, right? When you are trying to find out a reason, you're trying to find out the cause of something, right? So he got a prize. The next year, his science fair project was testing the theory that viceroy butterflies copy monarchs. This is a very, very important part. This is the gist of the chapter, this paragraph. The next year, his science fair project was testing the theory that viceroy butterflies copy monarchs. So he had worked a lot on monarch butterfly. There are other butterflies that he's talked about. Viceroy butterfly was one of them, right? The theory was that viceroys look like monarchs because monarchs don't taste good to birds. Now, if the monarch butterfly does not taste good to birds, it won't eat it, right? So the viceroy butterfly tried to look like the monarch butterfly so that it could be saved. So the birds would not eat them, right? Quite smart. Viceroys, on the other hand, do taste good to birds, right? So the more they look like monarchs, the less likely they are to become a bird's dinner. What does this mean? The less likely they are to become a bird's dinner. Then they won't eat. So the viceroy butterfly copying the monarch butterfly. See, adaptation, and as we say, that survival, everybody here wants to survive. Different ways to find of surviving, okay? Right. So we need to stop here today.